the emotion. She met Dianne when they were on Radio 1 many, many decades ago. And the BBC Philharmonic now, with their version of Elbow's One Day Like This. You are listening to BBC Radio Manchester. We are live at Manchester Cathedral for Dianne Oxberry's memorial. Stirring One Day Like This, performed at Manchester Cathedral live this afternoon by the BBC Philharmonic as part of Dianne Oxberry's memorial service. King Dianne Oxberry, final words there with Lem Cisse. He wrote those words for her. And here, her favourite song. How fitting, Mr. Blue Sky, ELO, performed by the wonderful BBC Philharmonic Orchestra. BBC Philharmonic Orchestra live at Manchester Cathedral and close.
Eamonn O'Neal.
BBC Radio Manchester.
And a very good evening to you. I'm Eamonn O'Neal, and over the next hour here on BBC Radio Manchester, together we'll celebrate the life of Dianne Oxberry, my colleague for many years and someone I counted as a friend, and many of you, even though you may not have met her, also will have counted as a friend dropping right into your living room every evening. Today we said goodbye to Dianne and we celebrated her life at a memorial service at Manchester Cathedral. And here's a taste of what made Dianne so special.
Welcome to a British summer here in the northwest of England.
Good of you to come in. In the cold.
Sometimes you are actually funny.
Dianne, how's it going?
Just one question.
What?
Does my bum look big in this?
It's a family thing, is now festing out, rather than not just presenters. It's like a family show.
Somebody who knew her stuff, she knew what she was talking about.
Not yet a named storm, but we do have the potential to see some pretty strong winds and some heavy rain as we go through Friday. Hello and welcome to a new series of Inside Out with me, Dianne Oxberry.
You've not been in the office much. You spent a lot of this week at Tatton. Are you still on full pay?
I am, but it's not as good as yours. But that's a whole other story.
This is how I have always wanted to appear on television. Head to toe in rubber and not a scrap of makeup.
You just felt like you knew her.
She brought into your own living room a really warm personality.
Typical media type. Okay. When work needs to be done.
Okay. She was always smiling. I mean, I think that even when the weather was miserable, she'd bring it forward with a smile.
If you don't like those charts, this might be the one that you like. You can see that the warm air is moving out of the way and the cool air is coming back in, so that makes more sense to you.
Hi! It's roasting, Dianne!
Well, you just do it then!
It's roasting outside! You know, everybody's so happy!
I'm going to come to one of your concerts and come on stage and just
climb on your knees. It's God love Dianne Oxberry. God love her. You've made it sunshine for everybody.
For once.
She saw and named storms with clear and hazel eyes. I shan't think of her as passed away. I'll think of her as sunrise.
And those final words from Lem Cisse, MBE, the poet. She saw and named storms with calm and hazel eyes. I shan't think of her as passed away, I'll think of her as sunrise. Beautiful words. And from one extreme to the other with Peter Kay, of course, as we discussed, we heard Roger say this afternoon, and Tony Livesey as well, who you'll hear from this evening, nothing could faze Dianne. And you'll remember when Peter Kay gatecrashed the weather, made a bit of a fool of himself, as he always does, and that's his style, and nothing threw Dianne. She handled it all beautifully. But Peter then summed it up, didn't he? God bless Dianne. She brought us all some rise. Now, Sunshine, I should say. Now, Jackie Brambles was one of Diane's oldest friends when they first met in London at Radio 1. Diane had come down from Washington, Tyne and Wear, and Jackie from Scotland. And if you don't mind, just to set the scene about Diane, I just want to read out to you the piece that Jackie Brambles had written in Today's Order of Service at the Cathedral. And this will put Diane into perspective before we go on to hear from Ian and all the other people who are talking so wonderfully about Diane. Here's what Jackie says. What I felt made Diane such an extraordinary human being that not many people realised was that her bright and breezy manner was not born of an easy journey. She endured more hardship than most, losing her father as a teenager, losing her sister when she was 30. The family that she nurtured so lovingly in the last decade of her life didn't fall into place easily. She could have justifiably viewed life through a far bleaker lens, but she didn't. She chose to see her glass as half full, and she chose to live her life in the sunshine, to see it out, to drink it in, to believe in it, and to reflect it back to anybody and everybody who crossed her path. That's who she was when we met 30 years ago. I thought she was dazzling then, and it makes me so proud to see this mass outpouring of love for her now. She would be incredulous to see it because she had no idea how amazing she was. Those are the words of Jackie Brambles, one of Diane's oldest friends. And today Jackie shared a reading with us at the Cathedral, and she struggled through it, in fairness, because she's very emotional. But at the end, she did say to us, if Diane was here now, she'd be saying to me, oh, pull yourself together. So today we had a fairly sombre at times, a sad at times, but also an uplifting and happy at times celebration at the Cathedral, and more about that a little later on. Diane and I were thrown together professionally by one of the managers at BBC Radio Manchester, who thought we would make a good double act. And actually we did. We just clicked straight away. We worked together on the mid-morning show on BBC Radio Manchester. Then we, I don't know whether it was promotion or demotion, to the breakfast show, when we did that for a couple of years together. And I can honestly say, you know, when you get up at 4 o'clock and you come to work and you're there at 5 o'clock, you need something to chivvy you on through the morning. And none of us, none of the production team, none of the rest of us, were ever down as soon as Diane arrived. But it's not just about us, of course, the colleagues. It's more about the family. And in putting this tribute together, I wanted to speak to Diane's husband, Ian, who also does work in the business, but not in front of the camera. And he's a very understated, lovely person, Ian. And he's kept his own counsel through this very difficult time. But he did want to just break out of the privacy for a moment, because he wanted to talk and he wanted to say thank you to you for all the support that you've given and the fantastic response to the appeal that he's launched in Diane's name. More on that later. Diane was very down to earth, as I'm sure you've gathered by now, and she made such an impression on everyone who met her. When Ian first met her, it was in Studio B at BBC Studios in Oxford Road, when they were working together on a kids' programme called The 8:15 from Manchester. Ian remembers it well.
There was a singer called Sonia who was supposed to be appearing on a show, a Saturday morning kids' show that I was working on called The 8:15 from Manchester. And I think it was the first week that Diane was actually working on it, first time she'd sort of come up from London. And because I wasn't doing a camera that week, I was doing something called cable bashing. Because she was late, I had to get up on stage and pretend to be Sonia so they could block out the camera shots as they did. And I was singing and dancing to a Sonia song when Diane first saw me. And she always claims that she said she saw me and said, I'm going to marry that man. Which is, and she always said, I mean, it wasn't like something she said to me afterwards, I just made it up. She said, no, I honestly thought that. Which is sort of incredible when you think back, you know. Anyway, I would never have asked to present her out, and there wouldn't have been a chance of that, but I found out that she'd asked, did I have a girlfriend? And I said, well, I wasn't going out with anybody at the time, so I said, do you think I could get a number? So I got a number, gave her a call, and that basically was it. We just started going out whilst she was doing the series, and we never looked back. And I think after a year, we got engaged. I remember it was in a hotel in Stone. I was working in that area, and she'd come up to see me. And then a year after that, in May of 1993, we got married.
She stood out in those days, didn't she, from all other presenters? Because, I mean, she obviously had a huge smile, but even then, she was an extraordinarily ordinary person.
Oh, yeah, she was completely down to earth, and there was no... There was nothing sort of starry or she was just easy to get on with and just very, very natural. And that's what attracted me to her. So I knew after we'd only been going out for a few weeks, I thought it was special. It was different to other people I'd dated. She was brilliant. She took no nonsense as well. She was like she knew her own mind, which I liked.
Did you always, therefore, after that, have yourself on camera one, which was the presenter's camera?
Yeah, I always went onto camera one after that. Yeah, no, that's not quite true, obviously. But I think I worked on most of that series with her, and then we got married, but she was still living in London at the time, but I was doing quite a lot of work at BBC in London, so I spent quite a lot of time down in London where she lived, and then when things changed at Radio 1 and she had to get a new job, she came up to Manchester and started working on GMR, or it wasn't Greater Manchester Radio, whatever it was. So we eventually moved in together in Sale, and then in 1996, we bought the house that we're still in. And I think it must have been around about 1996 that Dianne started doing the weather on the TV. And it was just, she's never looked back from then since. She's just been fantastic.
I think weather presenters have always been underestimated because I think the viewers don't realise the amount of work that individual puts into it, the study, the meteorological understanding, actually doing all the graphics, writing the script, and then, of course, she stands up and presents it without an auto cue. She never regarded that as being anything out of the ordinary, and yet it was amazingly difficult to do.
Yeah, I think that Dianne never seemed to recognise that that was a major part of what made her such a good presenter. She could stand in front of the camera and she could talk. And as you well know, Eamonn, quite a lot of the time on North West Tonight, it's a sort of very fluid as the amount of time that she'd be given at the end of the programme. So she could have 2 minutes, she could have 4 minutes sometimes if a package didn't run properly. And Dianne would always fill that time. They always gave it to Dianne because she could just do that. And I've worked with a lot of people over the years, and it's a really difficult skill to be able to achieve, to be able to stand there and talk to time. And Dianne could always do that. I mean, she was so natural at it. It was actually amazing to see her do it. And it didn't matter. I would always say to her, I can't believe you did that. Because sometimes I'd go out and shoot stories with her very occasionally. I'd be shooting stories for when she was doing Inside Out. And she could just do it straight off. There was she might take a couple of, it might be one or two takes because she'd say, I want to do that again. But there was no messing about. She just got it done. She was amazing.
Absolutely no messing about in any aspect of her life. That was Ian Hindle. More from Ian in a sec. Ian is Dianne's husband. This is a special programme on BBC Radio Manchester. I'm Eamonn O'Neal. It's a tribute to our friend and colleague, Dianne Oxberry, who we remembered at a service today at Manchester Cathedral. But listen, we're not going to get maudling and we're not going to get downbeat in this hour because it's very, very sad, obviously, that we've lost Dianne. But those of us who knew her socially and professionally knew that she was never downbeat. She was never maudling. She had a great sense of fun and she always wanted to grab life by the scruff of the neck and go for it. Just over a year ago, Dianne recorded a programme here on BBC Radio Manchester where she picked some of her favourite music, revealing her sense of humour, which was amazing, by the way, and her sense of fun. This is where she's talking about Whitney Houston and it's taking her back. And, just imagine now the theatre of the mind. Imagine Dianne Oxberry with probably not very many clothes on in Newcastle, as was the wont when you go out clubbing, at the Tuxedo Princess nightclub.
Just to hear her voice at the beginning of her career, it was a God-given gift. She found it so effortless to sing, and probably, I would say, one of the best female singers ever. And this takes me back when I lived in Newcastle and I just started going out with my sister and her friends on an evening. And we used to go out to a nightclub, a floating nightclub on the Tyne called the Tuxedo Princess.
Bet that was cold as well.
Well, if nobody ever wore a coat, we wouldn't know. But this one guaranteed to uplift you and get you on the dance floor.
So if you picture Dianne Oxberry with probably lots of hair at the time, as she said, no coat, probably, miniskirt and high heels, clubbing and a nightclub floating on the Tyne to that, Whitney Houston. So as I said, we're not going to get sad today at all. We are celebrating. There is sadness in the day, clearly. Your messages have been coming in all day, particularly during and after the service. Val Donahoe, for example, said a lovely service and one which she would have embraced. Just can't believe she's no longer with us. Dianne says, Val, you were like a member of our family whilst telling us the weather every night. Our thoughts go out to your family. You'll never be forgotten. And Karen Glazer told us, with the God and the angels now, RIP Dianne, a ray of happiness and sunshine to everybody. God bless your family. And Ian Smith, who we bumped into at the service, says Dianne brought sunshine to the rainiest of days, RIP. With me now is colleague Phil Trow, who was also with us at the service today at Manchester Cathedral.
Good afternoon.
And what a service it was, Phil.
It was. Do you know the thing that I enjoyed today? And I know it was a memorial service, but I think you've got to enjoy, you know, as much as you've got to reflect, was all the stories that came out. There was so much about Dianne that I didn't know. And thanks to our colleagues, Tony Livesey, I love the fact that the two used to get changed in the dressing room with Dianne, and there were some great stories from that. I loved Annabelle's little anecdote about one bit of advice, suck your bum in and your stomach will go flat.
Well, it was a cathedral. She said buttocks.
Did she?
She didn't say bum.
I apologise. This is the BBC. We can get away with that. I'll be trying it in future. And I think my favourite story was yours, the one about Guy Garvey, whose dad was a huge Dianne fan, of course, Guy Garvey from Elbow. And she put his name on the weather map. And I'm pretty sure I remember that episode of North West Tonight. And I just thought Don Garvey was south of Lancaster. And Don Garvey, of course, was,
no, it was
Guy Garvey's
Guy's dad.
Dad.
Yes. And Guy Garvey's dad didn't live for very much longer after that. And he brought that memory with him to his dying day, as Guy said. And he insisted that Dianne was flirting with him through the camera lens. No, we'll have to try and dig that tape out and see. People were asking, there were two dogs in the cathedral, unusually, and people said to me, are they Dianne's dogs? But they weren't.
No, I'd met Dianne's dogs on a couple of occasions, actually. But the two dogs in the church were from Retriever Rescue, who obviously Dianne used to support and get dogs from. And do you know, actually, you know I'm a dog lover. That was probably one of the poignant things for me, because during some of the pieces of music, I was just looking at the dogs. And of course, we all think about ourselves and obviously think about Ian and the children. But it always saddens me a little bit that the dogs, of course, who she was so close to, and you'll have seen all the tributes around Sale that people put up pictures of Dianne and said, I used to meet Dianne here with her dogs. Of course, the dogs will never see her again. And that must be quite confusing for them, the fact that, you know, if you like, their mum won't come home. So I just thought that was a really nice touch, actually, and, you know, nice of the cathedral to allow the dogs in.
And what I noticed about the dogs, and I'm sure you did too, when the congregation stood up, the dogs stood up.
Yes, they did.
And when we sat down, they sat down. It was fantastic.
They were gorgeous, weren't they?
They were gorgeous. And it epitomises the kind of spirit of Dianne in terms of animals, and we'll hear Ian talking about that a little later on. But as you were just saying to me earlier, it's hard to fathom that she's gone, because she was such a big dynamic force and such a huge part of everybody's lives, whether you worked here or not.
And you know, Rogers Govinda, who's the dean of the cathedral, I love the fact that he always, whenever I hear him, he always gives me food for thought, and he always says, you don't know how long you're going to be here for, but actually if you make the most of what you do and you leave an impression and you change people's lives and perspectives, actually you've done your job, and actually the amount of time you're here shouldn't really matter.
Good point. You can't guarantee to live long, but you can try and live well.
Yeah.
That was his message. And I think she did that.
Oh, undoubtedly.
Yeah. And we're going to miss her on BBC Radio Manchester and North West tonight. But, you know, we've constantly got to think about Ian and the children and the extended family. And we'll be hearing more from Ian before 6 o'clock. Thank you, Phil. Phil Trow, one of our BBC Radio Manchester colleagues, very close to Dianne. Of course, we all live in Sale. We're all the Sale guys, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
All I need is a dog, and I'm fully fledged member of the team. So we spoke to many people outside the cathedral who travelled from across the northwest to be there for Dianne, and here's a flavour of it.
She was just so lovely. Lovely, warm smile and part of the family, really.
Very bubbly and like a sunny personality sort of thing.
She's just a lovely person. Great professional. She was always so nice, although I've never met her in person.
And extend a very warm welcome to each and every one of you as we gather here in the cathedral to give thanks to God for Dianne Oxberry's life and to celebrate her life together.
Total strangers have wandered up to us, often in tears, and ask the question to which at the moment there really is no answer. Is it spitting in Fleetwood? To be honest, I'm not sure, because for me, it feels like the weather's stopped since we lost Dianne. Peter Kay said perfectly that she brought sunshine into all our lives, but any of us who live here know that she also brought mist, sleet, frost, fog, and regular cold fronts too.
She really did, as you've just heard, bring light into our lives every day, even though she was telling us that the Manchester heavens were going to open on us the next day. So how she did that while still giving us that lift is something that Dianne had. So today, on behalf of the people of Greater Manchester, I bring genuine condolences to Dianne's BBC colleagues, who we know miss her so much, of course, particularly to Dianne's family.
Some people touch her heart, and some people you really, really like.
I just thought she was just a fantastic person, and, you know, that's how she came across.
After Dianne died, her husband Ian started up a fund in her memory. The aim was to raise £1,000 to help kickstart a charity. But within a week, that fund had reached £30,000. It now stands at almost £50,000, and it's still growing. Hugely impressive, but it's perhaps not surprising given how much people love Dianne.
Dianne Oxberry was special to every one of us, and that is why we are here. To some, like me, she was a wonderful colleague. To others, a much loved friend. To Ian, Dianne's husband, their children and her family, Dianne was everything.
On one infamous night at Northwest Tonight, and if you ask anybody here who's from the programme, they'll tell you about it. Di, you've got 4 seconds on the weather. Cut to Dianne. Thanks, Annabelle. Rain. Good night. When I left, Northwest Tonight in 2013, she gave me a present. She didn't bother signing the card or anything like that. What she gave me the best present of all, and you won't know this until you go home tonight and watch the programme, but she gifted me the name Burnley on the weather map, and it's still there today. And the bosses don't know she did that. And now I've said it in public, you can't change it either. But just have a look when you get home tonight. Burnley, it's there. It's been there for 6 years, which I'm very grateful for.
Dianne Oxberry, he said, God love her. You've made the sunshine for everyone. She did.
Just a flavour of the memorial service at the cathedral today in Manchester. That was Roger Johnson towards the end. We'll hear more from Ian Hindledown's husband in a sec. But I used to present breakfast on BBC Radio Manchester with Dianne Oxberry, so we get to work about 5 o'clock. And I always wondered why she was so already on it, you know, as if it was the middle of the day. This next section that I'm going to play you explains it all, and it's all to do with Dolly Parton.
I love this record. I love this woman. I've loved her for about 20 years. She's a singer, she's an entrepreneur, she's an actress. She is just absolutely fabulous. Everyone's got on board in the last couple of years with an appearance at Glastonbury. She can rock the festivals. She's got a heart of gold. And I will do this one for karaoke, and I remember on Washway Road driving in to present breakfast on Radio Manchester about 7-8 years ago, and pulling up at the traffic lights at about 4:15 in the morning and belting it out at the top of my voice to get me going, and oops, alongside me pulled a police car, and it was so loud because he looked across at me and he just shook his head. This one, I hope you enjoy it.
Singing along to Dolly is a karaoke car way before all the other stars in Hollywood did it. It's BBC Radio Manchester. I'm Eamonn O'Neal, and we're celebrating Dianne Oxberry's life. It's just gone 5:30, though. Let's get the latest news headlines from you and Doak.
Well, as you've been hearing, a memorial service for the former BBC Radio Manchester presenter Dianne Oxberry has taken place at Manchester Cathedral. She died last month at the age of 51, less than a fortnight after being diagnosed with ovarian cancer. The inquests into the deaths of the 22 people who lost their lives in the Manchester Arena terror attack could begin in just over a year's time. That was the recommendation today as the latest pre-inquest review was held in the city. It also heard no significant progress has been made in efforts to extradite the brother of the Arena bomber, Salman Abedi. The junior farming minister, George Eustace, has resigned because of Theresa May's promise to allow MPs a vote on delaying Brexit if her deal is rejected. Mr Eustace said the pledge could lead to the UK's final humiliation. And Warrington Borough Council is set to become the first in the country to produce all of its own electricity. The council claims the project will generate millions of pounds in profits as well as cutting bills. The two solar farms are expected to be completed next year.
Thank you, Ewan. It's 5:30. Well, it's just gone 5:30 now. We get the very latest sport from Don Busby.
Thank you. The Bolton boss, Phil Parkinson, in the news today, giving his reaction to the news that players and coaching staff haven't been paid. It's all part of the ongoing distraction for the club as they attempt to hang on to their championship status and prepare, of course, for Swansea at the weekend.
Obviously, there's a lot going on behind the scenes. We understand that. I spoke to Paul Aldridge this morning about the wages, and he said he'd let me know as soon as he hears something. And as of yet, he hasn't contact me, so I'm waiting for that phone call, and you know, when I do, I've promised that I'll pass that message on to all the players and the staff.
Ole Gunnar Solskjaer doing great things at United. They have their 8th consecutive away win thanks to that victory at Crystal Palace. He's challenging his players to go one better next week.
You go into every game as a Man United coach with these players you've got, thinking that you have a chance to win every game. So the next one's away against PSG, so let's see if we can continue.
Rochdale have extended goalkeeper Andy Lonergan's emergency loan deal for another 7 days. The 35-year-old's now eligible for the Saturday League One fixture at Luton Town as regular first choice John Lillis continues to recover from injury. And the Salford halfback Jackson Hastings knows the Red Devils will start as underdogs tonight. Of course, they're taking on St Helens. He says that Justin Holbrook's men are one of the teams to beat this season.
They're the benchmark at the moment. I guess them in Warrington, probably the two best teams in the comp in terms of player for player and depth, and they've both got great coaching staff, so it's going to be a huge game for us. They're littered with England players and obviously other internationals as well, with Nguama and that coming to their squad, so you know, we're just going to turn up and do what we do, mate. Just perform to the best of our ability and give them a run for their money.
And Salford against Saints is the big match commentary for you this evening from 7 o'clock on 95.1 FM.
Eamonn O'Neal. BBC Radio Manchester.
Hi, I'm Eamonn O'Neal, and together on BBC Radio Manchester this evening, we're celebrating the life of our friend and colleague Dianne Oxberry. Remembered today by friends, colleagues, family and strangers. Not real strangers, though, those people who loved her because of her television and radio work, all together at Manchester Cathedral. We've already heard from her husband, Ian, and Ian was describing how they met, and also about Dianne's tremendous sense of fun and her down-to-earth approach to life. Still to come before we finish at six, a song that Dianne danced around the kitchen to, and more tributes from the team here at Radio Manchester who have worked with her for years. First, though, we go back to Ian, and Ian will share with us how Dianne's love of animals was legendary. And just before you hear from Ian, let me tell you this. This is a secret story. So Dianne and I presented radio together, and one of her dogs one day wasn't very well. So she brought him to work. She sneaked him in to the studio, and he was very well behaved. He just sat under the desk, and nobody coming into the studio knew he was even there until he started heaving and coughing. And I, obviously, as a true professional, just kept talking. Eventually, when the microphone was shut, Dianne just said, the dog's been sick on your shoes. So dogs played a big part of her life. So did horses, so did cats. And Ian explains a bit more.
Dianne was very keen on pets, animals, dogs, cats, horses. So one day, I remember she'd bought a horse already and she kept it at stables in near Dunham. And she said to me, it was also a place where they had dogs as well. And she said, oh, why don't you come this morning with me to look and see, look at these two retrievers? She said, I said, oh, all right. I was thinking, why do I want to go and look at two retrievers? But, you know, I went along anyway. And that later that day, I was having to travel to Scotland to do a job. And we got to the stables and she said, oh, what do you think of these two dogs? They were called Buddy and Bex. And I said, oh, they're really lovely, aren't they? They're fantastic. And they were jumping up and down, you know. And she said, can we have them? And I went, no, we're not having dogs. We can't have dogs. That would be ridiculous. And she goes, oh, what do you think I brought them to see? Brought you to see them for? So anyway, I went off on the outside broadcast and came back a couple of days later, and the dogs were in the house. So she just brought them home, which was what she loved to do. So you know, she I remember after that, I just thought, I can't even. I'm wasting my time even telling her. If she decides we're going to have a dog or a horse or a cat, we're going to have it.
But did she rescue animals as well?
Yes, she did. She liked to rescue animals as well, and sometimes she'd. I remember a story that a friend Jackie told me. She, I think Jackie was involved as well. They rescued a dog from in London and took it home with them on the underground and. It wasn't actually a dog that needed rescuing. It was belonged to somebody else. And it was only when they got it back home that they realised it got a tag on. They rang up and the bloke said, yes, I lost it in the park. And it's where they picked her up because they'd just taken this dog home.
But the horses were something special. And we all know, all the viewers and listeners know about Dianne's love for horses. And when our children were little, she brought them to the stables to have a look at the horse close up and the fearsome creatures close up. But can you put into words how much she loved horses and riding?
When Dianne was younger, she'd spend her weekends just going to the local stable, and she would hang out there on a Saturday and Sunday all day. I don't think her mum or dad had ever allowed her to have a horse when she was young, like a lot of young girls would like. And so when we got married, she said, I'd really like to buy a horse. So I remember the first horse was called Sam, and he was a bit wild. She bought a second horse. I can't remember what he was called. But anyway, we had two horses at the stage. I went away to the Sydney Olympics. I was working on the Sydney Olympics. And I remember while I was there, I phoned home. And she said, you'll never guess what I've done. And I said, no, but you're going to tell me. And she'd bought a third horse. So that stage, we had three horses. I mean, I kept saying, there's only one of you. So why have you got three horses? But, you know, it didn't seem to bother her. And she just... She just loved animals. But she had horses right up to, well, just about a year or so before she died, we lost the last one. She started our little girl riding, and she's now really into it in a big way, so that's really good.
She's going to continue the tradition, hopefully.
I hope so, yeah, because I think that's what Dianne would have really wanted.
That's Ian Hindle, Dianne's husband, talking about Dianne's love for horses. Dianne had a love for everything. She had a love for life. We heard you heard me read out what Jackie Bramble said earlier, and another friend, Joe Rosenberg, wrote in today's Order of Service. To me, she says, Dianne was a friend who gave me the courage to be myself. Her no-nonsense approach was highly infectious, not to mention her abundant energy. There was always a project on the go, and that's true. True at home, true at work, and true with the animals as well. And, you know, she used to walk the dogs in Sale, and I bumped into many people who I've never met before who got to know Dianne because of the dogs. And if you're a dog person, you'll know, won't you, that you walk along the street with a dog and you'll chat to anybody. And Dianne loved nothing better than chatting to other dog owners. Today, we heard from many people who had seen Dianne on television or heard her on the radio. And here's a couple more messages. Anne Woodward said she brought sunshine into our home. Gorgeous lady. Really miss her. Good night. God bless my lovely Dianne. Shirley Garner said a beautiful tribute to Dianne today. She was loved by so many. Hope the words that have been spoken bring great comfort to Ian and the children. R.I.P. And Jed Marsden, this is a really nice message from a chap called Jed Marsden who we met today. Jed says, a sad loss and a shock. A lovely tribute this afternoon, not just to Dianne the presenter, but to Dianne the wife, Dianne the mother and Dianne the friend. Jed says, I can't understand how quickly she's gone, but I wish Ian and their children the strength to endure, and may time mellow the pain and loss for them and all who knew her. Those lovely words from Jed, who we met at the memorial service this afternoon at the cathedral. One of the people who stood up at the lectern during the service and paid a really amazingly beautiful tribute was Tony Livesey. Tony was one of Dianne's colleagues on Northwest Tonight from 2006. He's now a presenter on BBC Radio. And his tribute today was poignant, was pertinent, but it was also very, very funny and amusing and just captured the spirit of Dianne brilliantly. Let's have a listen.
I can't speak for Gordon or Ranveer or Roger or Annabelle, but I know without asking that since Dianne died, we've all experienced the same thing. Total strangers have wandered up to us, often in tears, and asked the question to which at the moment there really is no answer. Is it spitting in Fleetwood? And to be honest, I'm not sure because for me, it feels like the weather's stopped since we lost Dianne. Peter Kay said perfectly that she brought sunshine into all our lives, but any of us who live here know that she also brought mist, sleet, frost, fog, and regular cold fronts too. In fact, when you think about it, that was what proved Dianne was far more than just a regular broadcaster, because her job, by and large, was to stand there on the telly every night and deliver bad news. Well, Roger, Garstang is flooded. Meanwhile, at home, even in Garstang, people are saying, hey, Dianne's great. Well, Annabelle, the whole of the Ribble Valley has a hosepipe ban. Anyone who flouts it will be arrested. Quick, love, before you walk the garden, Dianne's on. And in breaking weather news, Barrow in Furness has been washed away by a monsoon. Hey, have you seen Dianne's shoes tonight? Didn't matter what she said. She was, without doubt, an oasis of loveliness in all our lives in front of that map. But the point I would like to make today, and the reason that hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, thousands of you wanted to be here this afternoon, is that Dianne Oxberry was much, much, much more than a weather presenter. Mum, wife, great friend, inspiration, fighter, comedian, campaigner, journalist, smart as a whip, with a lilt in her voice like a symphony that washed over us at 5 to 7 every night. And as a result, she made the world all right. I said at the time that she died, I tweeted out that she was everybody's friend and nobody's fool. When I stood in for Roger or Gordon, I always wanted to be the one who handed to Dianne so I could try and catch her out, make a joke, make fun of her, but she was too smart for that. She was my guide as I made my way in live TV. She was the consummate pro. Each night, the director in her ear would count her into the weather And Dianne, famously, everyone who's worked with her knows this, she could work to the precise second. Di, you've got 1 minute 30 on the weather. Next, Edby. Di, you've got 2 minutes 30 on the weather. On one infamous night at Northwest Tonight, and if you ask anybody here who's from the programme, they'll tell you about it. Di, you've got 4 seconds on the weather. Cut to Dianne. Thanks, Annabelle. Rain. Good night. She didn't flinch. You could have forgiven her every night of her life, Dianne. She could have swanned into town on some social engagement or other. She was constantly being invited to things. Instead, every night, she'd just leave the building, check if it was raining in case her forecast was wrong, and then head home to Ian and the kids. She was fabulously normal, was Dianne. She'd be flabbergasted by all this. In fact, I'd go as far as to say, if Dianne was here today, she wouldn't be here. She'd be honoured that we're all taking the time to think about her, but she'd rather be out with the family having fun away from the fuss of television. Maybe, just maybe, because Dianne was so fabulous and so nice, that she might just pop that earpiece in for one last time so we could, at this point, all lean over the director's shoulder, press the button on the microphone and say, Dianne, we love you.
Wonderful words from colleague Tony Livesey. And now the BBC Radio Manchester's team wanted to have a few words to be said in tribute. Here are some of the team from our little gang here. Some voices you'll recognise and some are from behind the scenes.
Dianne Oxberry was talented, smart, funny, kind and generous. She didn't suffer fools, but she was welcoming, warm and supportive, especially to those just starting out in broadcasting. She had a natural ability to connect with viewers and listeners. It's a wonderful gift to possess. I don't think you can learn it. You can practice it, hone it, and polish it, but the core talent is inborn, it's not acquired. Dianne will be sadly missed by all of us, lucky enough to have known her.
She was the ultimate professional, but also sassy, no-nonsense, hugely funny and so full of energy and life. And she was really supportive of women too.
Well, I was lucky enough to work on and off with Dianne for many years here at BBC Radio Manchester. She was always a joy to work with, always positive and upbeat, even on those early breakfast programme shifts, which start at 5 o'clock in the morning when everyone's got a right to be grumpy. But not Dianne. She was always so positive. When the two of us travelled to Blue Planet Aquarium, where Dianne was going to be and did swim with sharks for comic relief, I have no idea if she was really nervous or terrified. But you never would have known. She was so professional on air, professional all the time. You know, she was never flustered. She was just so razor sharp. She always said the right thing, always had the perfect line to say on air and off air as well. And we'll miss her. We'll miss her a great deal.
I think one of my favourite memories of Dianne was she'd always come in to do the weather forecast at 5:30. And no matter what the weather, whether it was a summer's day, whether it was baking temperatures, even if it was a mild day, she would always come in a coat. And obviously, because this is radio, you never used to be able to see it. And it always used to smile because she was absolute perfection on Northwest Tonight. She always wore the most stunning outfits. And yet when she was sat in front of me at 5:30, she used to have this coat, not only wearing the coat, she used to have it wrapped around her as tight as possible, arms folded. And she always used to give me that funny little knowing look as if to say, don't you mention this, Tro. So no matter what the temperatures, no matter what the forecast, she would always be wearing that coat. But you know, she wore it with style.
Dianne Oxberry. Wow, so many memories. I'd actually known her a long time before I started at the BBC, but we kind of regained our friendship when I joined to do the Drive Time programme and she would come in and do the weather every night. I know Phil's mentioned she was always in a coat. She would always be late too, and I would be literally starting to chat about the weather and she would clearly hear me from some point in the office and leg it right across the entire length of the BBC building and into the studio, but then just sit down as graceful as ever and deliver the weather bulletin as if she'd been sat there for hours waiting for me. One time particularly springs to mind, which was when she'd come in and she said, Dianne Oxbury's here with the latest weather, what's it going to be like? And she did this entire weather forecast, and at the end of it I just said, and what you don't know, listener, is that during that whole weather forecast, Dianne has managed to successfully peel a full satsuma. And she had, and she said, how dare you tell everyone the truth. We had a great laugh. I was always late to press the news and sport junction after she'd been in because we didn't realise it had ended because we were still gossiping. And I'd like to be a bit more Dianne. She was brave and she said what she felt and she thought, but she always did it in a very respectful way, and she'll be really missed.
Thoughts and memories and tributes to Dianne from her colleagues here at BBC Radio Manchester. You heard there Phil Trow, Matt Trewern, Jimmy Wagg, Kate Squire, Helen Brown, Simon King and Chelsea Norris. But let's now hear more from Dianne's husband, Ian, who's finding a difficult way through dealing with the loss of a wife and the mother of the children, as you can expect. But Ian has found a way of dealing with it. He's in the process of setting up a charity to support families affected by ovarian cancer. As you'll hear, he's determined something positive will come out of this terrible situation. But first, he describes Dianne's final few days.
We went into the Christie on Friday, the 4th of January. She was taken to the oncology assessment ward, where some lovely nurses, there were some absolutely amazing staff in there, really looked after us, looked after Dianne. And it wasn't, I was on the Monday, I was informed by the oncologist who was in charge of her case that Dianne had quite a few complications, and it was almost impossible to believe what was happening at that stage, because we had not an expectation that she would survive, but an expectation we might have had a lot more time left together, because Dianne passed away only 3 days later. It was an awful time, not just for myself, but for obviously the children as well, and the rest of the family who are all suffering Dianne's loss tremendously, and all the friends. I haven't actually been able to watch any of the or listen to any of the radio or watch any of the television that was broadcast on the day that it was announced that Dianne died, but I know from what people have told me that, you know, the outpouring of shock and grief from people who, whilst they didn't actually know her, they might not have met her, they felt like they did know her because she was on their TV screens most nights of the week, and they had an affinity with her, or Dianne had an ability to, I don't know, she just it was very, very good with people. And it was a genuine way she behaved with people. She was no different when you met her than she on the screen, than she was off the screen. And it was, that period was very, very difficult to deal with, the grief, which I'm still struggling with now, really. I know it's only like 7 weeks now since Dianne passed away, but it's the thing that you have to carry on with. You've got children, they have to be looked after. And we all have to sort of go on as a family, and I don't think coming to terms is the right expression to use for losing a wife and a mum. But you have to live with it, and learning to live with it and adapting your life is incredibly difficult.
In her honour, you've created the Dianne Oxberry Trust, and another example of huge outpouring of love and generosity from members of the public when you wanted to crowdfund to raise £1,000 to seed fund the charity.
Well, I thought that it would be, because I knew that people had responded in an incredible way, members of the public, an unbelievable way had responded to Dianne's passing, I thought the best thing really to do would be to try and set up some sort of fund that would be, or that would sort of reflect Dianne, but also at the same time could do good for anybody who might suffer, specifically, obviously, from ovarian cancer in the future. So we decided to set up the crowdfunding page. I can't remember the exact timescale, but it was ridiculous. I couldn't actually believe how many people were contributing. You know, the presumably that it would be the same members of the public who responded to Dianne passing had decided, no, I can do something to help. And I can't. It's hard for me to put into words how amazing that is, that people who, like I say, hadn't. A lot of people had met her and loved her, but a lot of people hadn't met her but still loved her and wanted to contribute. And I find that absolutely, utterly extraordinary. And it has given me some solace to know that she's had a massive effect on people's lives. It is quite extraordinary. And looking at, what we've raised today, it's just hard to imagine. It's hard to imagine that, but again, it's a massive reflection on the way Dianne was a person. She was an absolutely Dianne was an absolutely amazing wife and an amazing mother. I mean, so this is a tribute to Dianne for what everybody has done outside to give the money to the charity when it will be set up properly.
What would your message be to all those people who love Dianne, who perhaps never met her but welcomed her into their living room every night, or listened to her on the radio and have now contributed perhaps just £5, £10, £20 towards the huge amount of money you've raised, which is, between £40,000 and £50,000 now?
My message to those people would be, I can't thank you enough for what you've done. I can't. Your generosity and your love for Dianne has meant that we've now got, money that hopefully in the future we can have an effect on people's lives who are suffering from ovarian cancer or who will suffer from ovarian cancer. That's what I would like to see. But you've been so fantastic in giving and showing your love and appreciation for Dianne that it's hard for me to say, but thank you. All I can say is thank you, and it really has helped me in really dark times.
That's Ian Hindle, Dianne Oxbury's husband. In life, you occasionally meet someone who pierces through the superficial stuff and gets straight through to your heart. Dianne was that person for Ian and the children. And we all experienced a little bit of it, and we all benefited from it. I'm going to finish the programme today, and thank you for listening. It's a song which brought back many memories for Dianne, and it was played, by the way, by the BBC Philharmonic at today's memorial service. I appreciate your time. This has been our tribute to our friend and colleague, Dianne Oxberry. We loved her and we still love her. Dianne, take it away.
This is a band that, and this happens with me a lot, first time around, I probably didn't appreciate them enough. But this is a record that's had a couple of re-releases. It's been tied into commercials. It's had a couple of reinventions along the way. And I guarantee everybody who's listening will know this one. It's got a bit of a Weather tie-in as well. But it's a really, really feel-good song. And this is a song that my kids, the minute it comes on, start bouncing around the kitchen to, because it's just got a fantastic introduction. It's ELO and Mr. Blue Sky.
Mr. Blue Sky, please tell us why you had to hide away for so long. Where did we go wrong? Hey there, Mr. Blue, it's a place to be with you. Look around, see what you do. Everybody's smiles at you. Hey there, Mr. Blue, it's a place to be with you. Look around, see what you do.
It's 3.